Coming up, WXXI News presents a special edition of Need to Know Rochester, Kodak's new chapter. After a long, slow decline, the company is filing for bankruptcy protection. We will walk you through what that means, and we'll talk about what Kodak has meant to the people who live here.
This is a special live edition of Need to Know Rochester, Kodak's new chapter. A look at the company that was once synonymous with Rochester, and a look at what's ahead for Kodak and this community.
Many in Rochester are calling it a sad day. Early this morning, Eastman Kodak Company announced it is filing for bankruptcy. Glory days are gone and the company's future uncertain. Thank you for joining us as we present this special edition of Need to Know Rochester, Kodak's new chapter. I'm Julie Philipp. Normally we come to you on Friday night, but today marks a major milestone in Rochester's long relationship with Eastman Kodak. It's a relationship that has lasted well over a century. The company in many ways defined Rochester's past, and in many ways it will shape Rochester's future. We begin our special report with Matt Daneman, who has been following the Kodak story for Need to Know Rochester. Matt is a regular on this program, and he covers business news for the Democrat and Chronicle. Tonight he's here to explain just what filing for Chapter 11 bankruptcy protection means for the company and the people connected to Kodak. Good to see you, Matt. Thanks for coming in. And it's been a long one. I apologize. Contacts can't read prompters after 24 hours.
I'm just excited to be sitting at the big kid table for once.
I'm glad to have you here. Let's talk about why now. What made this moment the right time for Kodak to decide we're going to file for bankruptcy protection?
It's an interesting question. You can take a look at it from sort of long view and from very short view. Why now as opposed to 3, 4, 5 years ago? Starting in 2004 through 2007, you know, the little history lesson. As we all know, Kodak went through some major upheavals, major downsizings, blew up the buildings at Kodak Park, all these sorts of efforts to basically cut away at its declining film business and sort of get ahead of the decline of the film business, shed all these unneeded assets that it did not, you know, that were surplus, and try to make its film business into something tight and uniform and small and sustainable and still profitable while its digital business grew. 2007, a profitable year for Kodak. It looks like that strategy works. Then 2008 up till right now, Kodak has been back in the same boat it was. It saw its sales continue to slide. It saw,
kept saying next quarter will be better, next quarter will be better, and next quarter
never
was
saw
never better.
Never saw profits, was still spending a lot of money investing in itself, was seeing some money spent on restructuring, and it just wasn't becoming that sustainable, profitable company. After a while, it didn't have much of a choice, it seems, in many eyes. And as history has shown out, it had to look at bankruptcy at some point. You're talking about a company that had said at the beginning of the year, we're going to end the year with about $1.6 billion sort of cash in hand to spend.
Not so.
And it doesn't look like it's going to be near that if you don't have the money to spend on paying your bills.
And so many of their suppliers were asking for COD, cash on delivery, if you can't pay.
And Kodak was saying itself today in the bankruptcy filings that a number of customers weren't even doing business with it anymore. Now the question is why now as to this week. You know, plenty of rumors out there and speculation that things were getting just too tight for the company. There might have been particular orders that necessitated this. Kodak is not giving any kind of answer whatsoever to that. The only thing Kodak would tell me is that the decision to file Chapter 11 to actually pull the trigger was made Wednesday afternoon. That up until that point it had been maybe we'll do this, but Wednesday afternoon became, you know, hit the red button.
Like you said, they're not doing any interviews. The statement that they released was fairly general. Was there anything in it that really stood out, or something that was not in it that stood out in your mind?
I think the glaring omission that I really wanted to see as a reporter covering Kodak, and I think the community wanted to see, was not only not in the statement, but also in the bankruptcy paperwork itself. There was not any kind of clear guidepost, any kind of map of what Kodak plans to do to become this sustainable, profitable company. There was a lot of talk in the bankruptcy paperwork and in the statements that Kodak put out publicly, in the video clips Antonio Perez did and such. we tried, the circumstances were against us, 2008 on, we've just had, you know, the economy, et cetera, et cetera. Nowhere was there really any kind of explanation of, well, here's what we're going to do to
really
fix things,
to
turn the ship around. We just know as a community, here's what the problems are, but we don't really have a good sense of the solutions. We have some indications and some rough ideas, but there's not that good answer of where this boat is going to turn in order to be a successful company.
Let's walk through what it means to be a company that has filed for Chapter 11 bankruptcy. What happens now? What's the process? What does it mean?
Well, as of actually right now as we're sitting here, there's a courtroom in Manhattan filled with lawyers representing creditors galore who all are going over the motions that Kodak has filed. Kodak filed a variety of motions with its bankruptcy paperwork, basically motions saying, hey, judge, allow us to spend money on things like paying our employees, allow us to spend money on keeping customer rebate programs going, all our sort of day-to-day operations. The judge is going over those right now as the creditors make various arguments back and forth. Longer term, you're going to see Kodak doing all sorts of motions that need court approval to make more substantive changes to itself. That's where we'll see the proof in the pudding of what Kodak is trying to do. If Kodak wants to sell X operation, or if it wants to cut back on these major benefits to retirees, all hypothetical. I don't know anything for sure. Judge is going to have to sign off on these things. There's going to be much back and forth with creditors. That's where you'll see the lattice work of what the next Kodak will look like. That's where it'll grow out of.
How long do these proceedings typically take?
Oh, man. you are talking about processes that can take months. You're talking about processes that can take years. Kodak has said that it wants to be out of Chapter 11 bankruptcy in 2013. So it's setting a fairly aggressive time frame, and maybe it's able to do that. It all kind of depends on, once again, these specifics we don't really know. But there's no one rule of thumb of how these things work. If I've learned one thing as a novice Chapter 11 student in the last couple of weeks, it's that there's no textbook for this. It's every case is very individual in a lot of ways.
Mm-hmm. You know, what happens if they do not come to terms with their creditors, that they can't come to this agreement, or the judge doesn't like their restructuring plan, doesn't approve of the things that they think they need to do? Is that a possibility?
There are a lot of ways this thing could all just go belly up. Chapter 11 could go through swimmingly and everything work out fine, and then the company finds itself back in Chapter 11 in a couple years, just like Hostess, if things don't work out, you know, post Chapter 11. If the Chapter 11 process itself doesn't work out, you could see the case just dismissed and Kodak is back sort of operating the way it was 24 hours ago, you know, struggling along. You could see it being even converted to a Chapter 7 bankruptcy, which is liquidation, which is sort of the death knell kind of situation. There are a lot of different scenarios where this all could go.
So a lot of people holding their breath. There are a lot of stakeholders. Let's walk through each of those stakeholders and sort of talk about what's at stake for each of them. I want to start with one of the biggest groups, and that's the retiree group. There are thousands of them in Rochester.
Really, tens of thousands. You know, I've heard estimates of anywhere from like 25 to 30,000 retirees living in the Rochester area. You know, if that doesn't count spouses and other people who are sort of dependent on that group, too. How this is going to affect them? Well, again, we don't know the details to that. The retirees, ECRA.
Was not included at all in the statement. I didn't see it.
It wasn't included what's going to happen to them, but the company made numerous comments and numerous statements about how one of the things that's been a real drain on it and a real anchor around its neck has been post-retirement benefits, post-retirement health care, plus, you know, pension issues, too. Not so much in the U.S., but foreign. Given all the ink that Kodak put towards talking about how post-retirement benefits have been a real burden to the company.
It is a lot of money.
And it's a lot of money. I'm not poo-pooing that. No,
it's
it would not be a crazy bet to say that Kodak is going to look at making some major adjustments to what it provides in terms of health care coverage for its retirees. It did that back in 2008, and it looks like it's going to be coming around again. ECRA, the Kodak retiree group, has pretty much sort of resigned itself to this, and they're talking about trying to get a seat on the committee of unsecured creditors that will sort of negotiate with Kodak and help hammer out this Kodak restructuring and reorganization plan, just so they can try to secure at least some of what they have. But there seems to be sort of a fatalistic notion that what they have right now isn't going to last, that there has to be at least some pullback, and it's all going to be jousting about how far back it pulls. So retirees are going to get
though,
something.
At this point, though, it looks like the pensions are fairly safe.
According to the Public Benefit Guarantee Corporation, the Pension Benefit Guarantee Corporation, the federal agency that insures these things, Kodak's U.S. pensions are pretty well funded at around 86%. There's not major concern about those, that pension benefits should be relatively well secured. And besides, there are a number of federal laws that, for the large part, prevent Kodak or creditors from going after that money, though there are ways that can happen,
right,
as we saw with Delta.
At this point, that's not the top of the list.
That is
of
not
concerns.
Top of the list right now.
Moving on to current employees, I'm hearing a lot of nervous current employees.
And unfortunately, it's probably all well-warranted nervousness. In terms of their pay and benefits, Kodak is saying right now all the right soothing things, which is, hey, you're going to keep being paid, your benefits are still secure, nothing is going to really change in your day-to-day jobs. Unfortunately, you're talking about a company going through Chapter 11 and is going to look at cutting costs. So you're talking about a company that is, by definition, probably going to be like selling off parts of itself, going to be cutting certain operations, more job disruption at Kodak, which is something that we've seen since 1982, really.
And probably some disruption to the benefits they have as well.
That is a big question mark and remains to be seen. Kodak has not said anything along that line, so who knows? Who knows?
Okay. Let's talk about the managers in that group. They stand to lose quite a bit, it appears.
Well, the management structure at Kodak right now is the one still running the company, obviously with this sort of committee that will have say into things, and with judicial oversight. The issue becomes if the creditors of Kodak don't really agree with the plan that Kodak management comes up with, a trustee could be put in their place instead, and they could be out. So you have to
see a lot of unknowns.
Right? And meanwhile, all management is paid generally. The upper management, most of their compensation is in stock, and we're talking about a situation where their stock holdings already had been, you know, anemic to nothing anyway because of the way the stock has performed lately.
And that's the next group I was going to talk about. Investors have already taken a beating. It looks like all hope is lost for them.
Yeah, like you say, investors have taken it in the shorts quite a bit recently, and now I guess they're just going to get the last punch taken in because where do you go from 50 cents? There's not much likelihood that this stock is going to exist much longer. It is possible that current Kodak shares could see some value again if the total assets of the company are greater than the total liabilities of the company after everything all shakes out. That's always a possibility. The likelihood, according to numerous experts I talked to, is that in most cases what happens is that these stock shares that exist today throw them away because they're never going to be valuable again, that new stock shares would be issued at some point in the future once the company comes out of its Chapter 11, just like, you know, General Motors did, for example.
Mm-hmm. Another group, customers, people who rely on Kodak for service.
Well, in terms of how this is going to affect them, if you're one of the major secured, or not even a major secured unsecured creditor, but even a minor unsecured creditor, some small business that's still doing business with Kodak, and Kodak's a significant customer, this could be a problem. Definitely so. You in the federal court right now, you have attorneys representing many of these same unsecured creditors. Everybody just trying to joust to make sure that they get at least some of what's coming to them, because we're talking in many cases about tens of millions of dollars that Kodak has standing out to this unsecured or that unsecured creditor. And, you know, small businesses don't even have the financial wherewithal to send fancy lawyers in wingtip shoes to Manhattan.
To fight this, yeah. And as part of the bankruptcy filing, Kodak had to list some of its major creditors.
Yes.
Have you taken a look at that list?
Yeah, the major secured creditors are all big banks that had loaned Kodak hundreds of millions of dollars and have collateral lined up for it. Nobody has to worry about them too much because, A, they're really big banks with collateral, and they have plenty of clout in this process. The major unsecured creditors, it's an interesting mix of a lot of companies. You're looking, a lot of it is comes down to trade credit. Businesses that, you know, sold Kodak some, you know, gave Kodak some product, and Kodak's supposed to be, you know, cutting them a check for these plastic pellets or whatever, and that check just hasn't been cut yet, and then all of a sudden on Thursday morning, Kodak files for bankruptcy, and you're sitting there going, wait, they have $8 million of my inventory that they haven't paid me for yet. And that's what you see a lot with the largest unsecured creditors. A lot of interesting names, a lot of entertainment companies like Sony, for example, and Paramount, I believe, is in there.
A handful of local companies.
A handful of local companies, too, even in there. Optimation does a lot of industrial services for companies. The local ADECO, which does staffing and temp placement. So you're seeing even some local operations that also have quite a bit of money tied up in Eastman Kodak and what happens next.
Okay, and finally, you know, we've been hearing so many Kodak stories and memories today. What are you hearing while you're out there doing your reporting?
You know, it's interesting. I'm hearing from I've been talking a lot primarily to retirees, and because they're a huge stakeholder, and also they're people who are reachable during the day. Kodak employees are working. You're hearing almost two strains of thought. One is from certain retirees who you know, seen the writing on the wall, expected something like this to happen, just like much of Wall Street expected this to happen, and it seemed like the whole world expected this to happen the last couple months. And it's almost a resigned sort of, it's not a surprise it happened, it's surprising it happened today on Thursday.
Yeah, there was still some mild shock, even though everybody seemed to.
And I think that's understandable, because even if you expect Kodak to go bankrupt, there's still this moment that Kodak, which has been this corporate giant and such an iconic American brand and huge powerhouse in this company, and economic powerhouse in Rochester for so many decades, to find out still the disconcerting notion like it went bankrupt, it's probably the same thing that Detroit felt with General Motors. It just seems so strange in a way. And then the other strain of retiree fear that I've heard is a lot of fear. I mean, there's a lot of people very uncertain and very nervous about their health care benefits, even about their pensions, because anytime you're facing any kind of major change that could really affect you, especially when you're on a fixed income, that's a heck of a scary time to be in.
It is. Well, thank you so much for coming in on a Thursday night, and we'll see you on Friday night.
Always a pleasure.
Matt Daneman, Democrat and Chronicle business reporter, Matt Daneman, who provides weekly business analysis here on Need to Know Rochester. In a minute, we'll bring Reuters columnist and Pulitzer Prize-winning journalist David K. Johnston in. But first, despite the many warning signs, as we just said, it seems no one really expected to wake up this morning and find out Kodak filed for bankruptcy. Nearly everyone we interviewed today expressed some shock and a lot of sadness in response to the news. We caught up with Lieutenant Governor and former Rochester Mayor Robert Duffy at an event downtown.
It is certainly a day where I understand the reaction. I say that this is not, we shouldn't throw our hands up in despair. I think we should just realize this is on one part a sad day, but also look at the opportunity ahead. I think that we want a strong Kodak. It's not Chapter 7. This is not liquidation. This is Chapter 11. It's restructuring. And there's certainly going to be pain along the way, but Rochester is strong. Rochester has tremendous talent. The governor stands ready to help any way that he can. Kodak has defined Rochester for decades and even before that. And so certainly I understand the impact even if an announcement like this has on all of us here, the psychological impact, let alone the economic impact. But it's time to roll up our sleeves and get to work and support this company any way that we can and just hope and pray that this can be turned around, strengthened, and Kodak grows, gets stronger, and stays here. We have probably 25 to 30,000 retirees here. This is a Kodak city. It's a Kodak community. The impacts on people that aren't there in terms of, I'm sure, pensions and health care, people are concerned with that. But I have a sense that Antonio and his team are going to work very hard to keep what they have and try and get the strong bones of that company going again.
I think everybody is sad. I don't think anybody should be shocked that Kodak made this announcement today. They've been leading up to it. But it's one thing to hear them talk about it and actually see them take the action of going into bankruptcy. You know what, people need to focus on where we are as a community versus the emotion. I know everybody has that emotional attachment to Kodak. It's part of our history. It's defined who we are in so many ways. That's really not the case anymore.
This isn't the death of a company. This is the reorganization of a company. They have a lot of talent within that organization. That talent will still be here, and I think the resilience of this community will pull us out. We're a much more diversified economic base. Not all, the suppliers aren't all totally dependent on Kodak like they were 25 years ago. So again, I think pain, yes, but still in all, we'll pull through this.
For more reaction, go to our website at WXXINews.org. We'll also be collecting your Kodak stories this Saturday at the Rochester Public Market. WXXI's Innovation Trail team will be at the Yards Gallery Space above Flower City Bread Company from 9 to 3, recording personal stories and observations about Kodak. We invite you to participate. You can just show up, but to guarantee a spot, we recommend reserving one ahead of time, and you can do that on our website, WXXINews.org. As promised, David K. Johnston is here. He is a columnist for Reuters and a distinguished lecturer at Syracuse University. And he's got a Pulitzer Prize tucked in a closet somewhere for reporting he's done for the New York Times. Thanks for joining us. And next to him is WXXI's Innovation Trail reporter Zack Seward, who covers the upstate economy for us as it undergoes its own transformation into sort of the digital global age. David, I want to start with you, the professor. About three decades ago, Kodak was at the top of its game. Somewhere along the way, the game changed. Kodak failed to keep up. Kind of walk us through what went wrong from sort of a business case perspective.
I don't think anything went wrong. Kodak is a classic business problem that should probably be taught in every business school. What do you do when you have a monopoly product, Kodachrome film, with tremendous margins and nothing else you can invest in will make the same amount of money? So Kodak went out and bought other companies, Sterling Drug being perhaps the biggest example, where there was no, they did not succeed, and I don't think there was much opportunity to make the same profit. So what do you do in that kind of a business situation? Because all monopolies eventually will fail. Even if you're in the alcohol business, you know, someday we'll have a Star Trekian world with Synthahol and the Scotch
hard to
companies.
Believe, but you're right.
And so once in 1975, Kodak built the first digital camera, which had an image of one-tenth, I believe it is, of a megapixel. The world began to change for them. And Kodak began selling convenience. The brownie, you know, you point and click. You click, we do the rest. And so once the digital camera came along, Kodak only could survive, as we've known it, if they got into that business. Well, Kodak hasn't principally been a camera company. And secondly, where's the profit margin in this? It's a commodity business.
Right.
It's highly competitive, and who have we seen move into it? Well, even the people who went into cameras, those are going away because everybody has one on their cell phone.
Mm-hmm.
So this is really a story of the life cycle of a company. And the other one troubling part about it is during the years when there were these tremendous profits, and the company, in my view, should have paid bigger and bigger dividends to those who held their stock, they should have put a lot more money into funding these programs they promised retirees. And I think this is a big national issue we need to think about in terms of how we fund this and the risks people take. You go to work for a company when you're young, things don't work out, you can leave. But people who stay with a company past 50, they have a much bigger risk factor than the company does with them.
Right, and Kodak employees did stay for a long time.
Sure did.
For some time. Now, not everything was bad coming out of Kodak during these years. Kodak really had a major impact on so many institutions in this community.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, you talk about that, not only the cultural influence, but also this upheaval that occurred over the last 20 years, essentially, with people being forced out of Kodak or leaving Kodak for other opportunities, seeing the writing on the wall. So I put together a piece just earlier today about some of the ideas and people that are flowing out of Kodak and basically into new ventures.
High-tech inks that can be printed onto circuit boards and consumer electronics.
So you could print my flat-screen TVs.
Yeah, well, yeah, not tomorrow, but maybe someday.
Bob Knoyer is the president and CEO of the nanotech company, but before joining Intrinsic, he put in 33 years climbing the ranks at Eastman Kodak. As we talked with Knoyer just hours before Kodak's Chapter 11 bankruptcy filing, he expressed sadness over Kodak's decline.
I drive into work every day by parking lots that I only wished I could get into back when I started with Kodak, and now they're all empty. I can remember the days when it was just staggered starting hours so the traffic could move and all of that. Well, today that's not an issue.
It's a common refrain in Rochester, where Kodak is a shell of its former self. But that doesn't mean Knoyer isn't using former Kodak resources to propel his venture-backed startup. Three-quarters of Intrinsic's Rochester staff are former Kodakers, and the company is a tenant at Eastman Business Park.
I've worked in this building when I was a Kodak employee. This was a health and safety building.
In this building?
In this particular building, I'd have meetings and visit with people.
Leveraging former Kodak assets and talent is a big part of Rochester's recent economic success. That's according to Mark Zupan, the dean of the Simon School of Business at the University of Rochester.
We've been an entrepreneurial community since the days of the Erie Canal. We were the Silicon Valley before there was a Silicon Valley. And the big three, just like in the heyday of Detroit, that continued to put us on the map. But it's always incumbent on looking to where the future is going to be.
Zupan highlights a number of Rochester firms that have spun out of the big yellow box. Companies as diverse as Carestream Health, satellite maker ITT, and cutting-edge lighting firm Moser Bear all draw on key Kodak technologies and people.
It's still being felt, and instead of thinking of Kodak moments, I think we need to think more broadly of the Kodak imprint on the community. It's a legacy. It'll persist through the former alums of the firm, the spinoffs, and through the universities that George Eastman and Kodak so generously supported.
But Zupan says Kodak's success also led to complacency. Zupan says the Kodak lesson his school is teaching future executives is to stay agile.
But the other important lesson is you got to stay humble and you got to stay hungry, because if you don't keep performing, you get relegated to the past.
So you guys are the materials end of that equation.
Yeah, which is...
That makes sense.
We're a materials company.
Back at Intrinsic Materials, CEO Bob Knoyer says it's a lesson he witnessed firsthand. The way he sees it, Kodak helped prime the pump for Rochester's innovation engine, and companies like his now hold the keys.
It has seeded the starts of many companies, and through the talent that it's created and made available through its unfortunate circumstances. And I'm sure somewhere in those companies, hopefully it's mine, but it'll be somebody's, will start another great concern, great company for the area.
Reporting from the Innovation Trail, I'm Zack Seward.
And we're back to Zack Seward. What are some of the products that some of these Kodak spinoffs, whether they're the people or the ideas, what are they producing here in Rochester?
Yeah, you have a whole array of things. You have these direct spinoffs like Carestream Health, which was basically sort of the healthcare wing of Kodak at one point. You also have, you know, the ITTs, which were in the spy satellite wing of Kodak. You have people from the Cold War being honored today as their time at Kodak that was classified is now being made public. So you have those direct spinoffs, and then you also have this sort of talent spinoff that's emerged either by choice or by force, as we alluded to earlier. In this case, here's a Kodak vet who was associated with the business, LCD projection technology that Kodak had invested in, but not heavily, ultimately sold the business in 2007. He followed that business ultimately to Dow Chemical, which then sold the business again in 2010. At that point, he exited that former business and took on this whole new material science venture with technology that he made himself familiar with in the Kodak research labs over the course of three decades. So you see these various trajectories coming out of Kodak, mm-hmm. Both on the raw human capital coming out and doing interesting things. We mentioned Optimation. That's a perfect example. A guy who put in 11 years at Kodak, who went on to build service and design the machines that print the film that Kodak makes. Mm-hmm. So it's a wide array of companies and
mm-hmm.
and ventures that have emerged out of this one kind of iconic Rochester company.
Now, is that having sort of a measurable impact on the Rochester economy? Is Kodak still really part of the lifeblood of this community?
Well, Kodak still has 7,000 employees. It hasn't gone away yet. Someday, but one of the things that's benefited Rochester is that because of Kodak and the company, some of the other companies, we have this enormously highly educated workforce. We rank in the top in the country, the top group in terms of the number of people who have doctoral degrees in physics, in chemistry, in some aspects of biology, in computer science. And so there's a fairly vibrant market here. You look at Rochester compared to Syracuse and Buffalo, we are doing dramatically better than they are. And we have our own capital market because of the fortunes made in the past, and that there were enough people in town who held on to their money used it wisely and backed various other ventures.
Mm-hmm. And it kind of manifests itself in different ways. I mean, you have a law firm in Albany that does a quarterly patent index, and Rochester always is performing well. And especially of late, the share of those patents that are coming from the big three, you know, the Kodaks, the Xeroxes, those are declining as other patent filings in the Rochester area are on the increase with people kind of trying to make their jump into entrepreneurship.
Mm-hmm. But you still can't say that Rochester has the healthiest of economies, although it may be better in comparison to others. What does a healthy Rochester look like? In some ways, the local economy is parallel to what's going on at Kodak, that this need to adjust to a new world has to happen.
Well, the economic engine in town now is the University of Rochester. That's the shift. And they're the largest employer, and clearly they're trying to develop their expertise. They're number one, I think, in the country in medical research grants, or one of the areas. And that's crucial. And maintaining in Rochester the cultural institutions that allow us to draw talent here, Jiva Theater, The Little, now part of WXXI. Having the Eastman Theater with the Rochester Philharmonic in a city of this size is extraordinary. And if we can maintain those, we can continue to attract and keep talent here, and people will grow various businesses. But, yes, they have to deal with the national economy. They have to deal with policies that discourage manufacturing in America and encourage financial speculation.
So they're dealing with what a lot of other communities are dealing with. It's not just Rochester and the loss of Kodak. But it's interesting you just rambled off a list of cultural institutions that might help keep some of these ex-Kodakers, the talent here, and other educated workforce members. A lot of those institutions have their roots in Kodak.
Yes, and you know, George Eastman left a lot to this community. He left it under endowed. He didn't leave a lot of cash to finance things. But in terms of institutions, we are one of the most richly benefited communities in America in terms of all the institutions that we do have. Wish he'd left a little more money here instead of to MIT, but there's no question that we're much better off for that. And we also have extraordinary public education. And, you know, the free dental care that was once financed by the Eastman fortune is still sort of around. There are dental clinics that provide care for people in this area that government does very little bit on a sliding scale because of that. So we're the beneficiary of, you know, more than 100 years of this view that I made my life here, I'm going to make the community do well as I do well, which is certainly not the ethos of modern American business.
I know, however, you have studied the outmigration of workers in this community. Is there a certain amount of time that we're looking at here that we've had, as you said, Kodak still has 6,000 to 7,000 employees, although now that they are filing for bankruptcy, there's some degree of certainty that those people will lose their jobs. Is there a certain period of time that we have to say, okay, this is the place where you want to stay, or are there more attractive places that they've already started to flow toward?
Well, there are people who've left. One of the oddities about migration in and out of this county is there's a big connection between Los Angeles, where I came from, and Rochester in both directions. So clearly there are some business connections there. But this is a function not of, there's no time limit on these things. It's a function of, do we have the political leadership locally, state, and at the federal level that will encourage the kind of investment here in the United States that will grow new fortunes? And do we have the policies in place to do that? And simply writing checks to businesses as subsidies, which is something we've been doing and WXXI has covered a lot, that isn't what's going to create that. It's finding ways to develop things invented here and turn them into products you can sell that there's a demand for.
Mm-hmm. And is that what you're finding out there as you're studying the innovation economy and tracking it?
I'd say so. I think the interesting thing that you hear often with sort of this diversified economy that economists tout is a strength of this region. I think the question becomes whether the collective endeavor of all those companies can support the kind of workforce that these giants like Kodak mm-hmm. once supported. And I think that's still very much an open question, whether or not these small companies can scale up. And that's what you hear when you go out to talk to these companies, whether we can scale up, whether we can get mm-hmm. to commercial scale, and whether we can do it here locally or whether that needs to be done elsewhere. And I think that's still the open question as to whether or not ultimately the health of the Rochester economy returns to an idealized past of bounty.
you seeing it go one way or the other, that they can scale up here?
Well, a big risk of that. I mean, we are now below national income averages. We used to be above. Mm-hmm. We still do have 372,000 jobs. I looked up today in a county of about 720,000 people. But it can go either way. And a lot of this has to do with economic policies that are not under local control. We have two big advantages to keep in mind beyond the cultural ones. Superb public education in a lot of our schools here and very inexpensive housing, which makes it attractive to a variety of people. And there are people, you know, like me, who grew up on the beach in California who think it's better to live here.
You like the snow, huh? Well, I guess in many ways, no matter whether you're Kodak or you're one of these spin-offs or you're a separate company, they all need the same thing in order to, A, come out of bankruptcy successfully, or B, scale up.
Yeah, a lot of it really relies on human capital, going to what David had mentioned earlier, and that's something you hear over and over and over again when you talk to companies, whether it's in telecom or manufacturing, you name it. You often hear that people found, hiring managers with these companies found an incredibly talented workforce in the Rochester area that they decided was worth investing in. And that's a good story that is sometimes untold. But on sort of the front lines of the business world, you hear that often, that the talent of the Rochester area, because of that long investment in human capital, be it with educational institutions or, you know, within the research labs of a Kodak, it really yields a workforce that distinguishes itself from a lot of metros across the country.
And Mayor Tom Richards keeps saying, you know, we can be sad about this, but in many ways we were better off having been the quintessential company town at one point in our lifetime.
Well, it's been a long time this has been coming. So lots of people who were thoughtful about it had the opportunity to create new businesses. There were managers who bought parts of the businesses of Kodak. Some of them succeeded in breaking off. Others continue to be dependent on the company and are going to go down with it. But Kodak itself still has very valuable resources, including patents, which at a minimum are very valuable in litigation in this world we have of patent litigation. The one thing to watch going forward about Kodak and the bankruptcy, since this was not what's called a prepackaged bankruptcy, is whether creditors suddenly turn and want to take the company apart and push it into a Chapter 7. That doesn't appear likely at this case, but if that happens, now that would dramatically change the picture.
Then we're talking about a different story.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you both so much for coming in today. It was very helpful. Reuters columnist David K. Johnston and WXXI Innovation Trail reporter Zack Seward. Coming up, we will talk with a local man who says his blood runs yellow. His personal and family connections to Kodak have spanned decades. But first, Need to Know Rochester recently sent reporter Helene Biandudi and videographer Marty Kaufman on a treasure hunt of sorts. They went to the University of Rochester campus to track down the Kodak Company archives. They were donated to the university back in 2004, and here is what they found.
What we're looking at here are some photographs of Kodak physical plant, and this is one of the earliest.
Tucked away in the Rush Rees Library at the University of Rochester is a piece of history.
This is Kodak Park. Building 9 in the foreground, this would be Lake Avenue. This photograph was taken July 31st, 1969.
It's Kodak history, an archive of millions of photographs and detailed historical records the company donated to the U of R in 2004. Archivist Nancy Martin says it's a mammoth collection she's still navigating through.
There's the advertising, there's financial, there is legal, which includes things about patents and things of that nature, legal battles that Kodak engaged in with other companies over time, lots of things about various Kodak products, cameras, films, paper.
One of Martin's favorite pieces in the collection is an annual report from 1919.
In November, the company had a field day of all Kodak plants that was held at Exhibition Park, and it tells what the employees consumed at this. So they consumed 1,250 gallons of ice cream, 50,000 cones, 800 pounds of sugar,
wow.
2 tons of ice.
8,000 suckers.
8,000 suckers. So where would you ever find anything like that? And you can just imagine.
What are reactions from people when because obviously you're going to come across photographs and documents that you would never expect.
That's
so
right.
So what are some reactions that you've heard through the years?
They always ask me to come and look at it. When researchers find something, they say, oh, come and look at what I have found. And often it's something I don't know about because the collection is so vast.
The collection also includes personal items like this scrapbook from Helen Williams. She oversaw the order department at Eastman Kodak in the 1920s and 30s.
And she was the supervisor of dozens of young women who probably came directly from high school into the work world. And she had such affection for them as if almost they were her own daughters. And she kept brilliant track of them. And whenever they got married, she would photograph them before they left. And here's Louise Thomas. And she was leaving and got married in May of 1927.
Through the history of a great company, by the use of these archives, people will be able to see what made the company great.
To help sort through the archives, the school enlisted former Kodak employee Martin Scott.
It's a chance for me to relive good memories. And while there's a lot of good stuff, physical stuff in the archives, what you don't get in a collection like this is anecdotal things. And I know a number of stories. I know where the bodies are buried.
Scott worked in the research lab at Kodak for 35 years. Now he volunteers at the Rush Rees Library. And as far as getting more info on where those bodies are buried,
I'd rather not.
Scott's tight-lipped about certain stories from his Kodak years, but he says the archives help fill in the blanks. He says they paint a picture of Kodak during its glory days.
And by using these archives in conjunction with things that are even now appearing on television and in print, they will be able to perhaps see how does a great enterprise somehow stumble and stop being a great enterprise.
I think that no matter what Kodak's future holds, it's a fabulous collection, and we want people in Rochester to use it.
Nancy Martin says residents haven't scratched the surface yet on the Kodak archives. She's hoping that will soon change.
Well, what we have here are the persuasive abilities of Kodak to demonstrate the use of color in advertisements as opposed to black and white.
All eyes are on Kodak after the company announced it filed for Chapter 11 bankruptcy protection. But Martin Scott says residents shouldn't forget Kodak's rich heritage.
I think Rochester will come more to appreciate what Kodak is a few years in the future when they think about what Kodak was. They will see what they have missed.
For Need to Know Rochester, I'm Helene Biandudi.
And now we have a living, breathing archive of Kodak memories, John Lawson. He is a vice president with Tompkins Financial Advisors in Pittsford and a former Kodak employee. And
correct.
We got to back up the truck a little bit because you grew up in a Kodak family even before you became a Kodak employee.
I did, Julie. I feel like I've been a part of the company since birth. My dad was there over 40 years, and my father-in-law was over 40 years, and my wife was there over 30 years. So, and lots of, you know, that's not unusual. That's fairly typical in this town for a lot of family members.
Was there ever any question growing up that you would not work at Kodak? Did you expect growing up to work there?
I worked for several different companies. I didn't join Kodak until 82.
So you were not going to go Dad's route.
I was waiting for Dad to retire.
Okay. You didn't want to work at the same place at the same
correct,
time.
Right.
What did your father do there?
He was, he started off, as did many of the Kodak folks, in roll coating down on Ridge Road, which was a fundamental part of the film production process. And then was manager of processing labs in Palo Alto, California, and Washington, D.C., and then moved back here in the early 60s in the color print and processing consumer markets division.
What was it like to grow up as a child in a Kodak family back then?
It was wonderful to meet all the people at parties that Mom and Dad would throw for friends and associates, and to meet the associates at the airport hangar. I'd go up and take Dad to the airport and pick him up when he came back, and just the people, really.
So it was a real tight-knit group.
It was a real family. There was real leadership by example and real camaraderie. And, you know, the previous speakers have referred to a monopolistic company and industry and all the luxuries that provides, but it was a real family affair. Mm-hmm. You look at the advertising. You go back to the J. Walter Thompson Advertising Company and the ads that they put together in the 70s. Kodak ads were legendary. You'd watch television to see the Kodak ads.
They were beautiful.
They were gorgeous.
And so now let's move on to when you started working there. What did you do at Kodak?
Well, I was doing, I was in employee benefits on the financial side, and then I started staffing the one-stop shop for executives in the 90s, where if a manager had a question on retirement or any of the benefits, the 401k plan or some of the stock awards, or they had a deferred comp program, they would come to me. So
and
I got
this. They had some nice benefits to ask questions about.
Kodak was renowned for its nice benefits. That's correct. One of the main concerns was to keep the union pressures out, and so the benefits were quite rich.
Mm-hmm. But it wasn't all financial, was it? You know, they call it the Ma Kodak or the Pa Kodak. The events and the softball games, that sort of thing. A lot of that went on, huh?
There was a softball stadium. A lot of people today don't realize it, but down on Lake Avenue, there was an old softball stadium, and Shifty Gears and his crew would play there, and they were nationally known for softball. In fact, I ran into a guy at a convenience store recently that worked at Kodak for one month 30 years ago, and he still had vivid memories of playing softball there. So regardless of how long or how long ago, people seem to really have a lasting impression of the company.
What would you say your favorite Kodak moments, your own personal Kodak moments, are?
I think it was really sharing in people's successes, getting to know people. A lot of times once somebody understands you have an empathetic ear, they'll share a lot of things with you. And was getting to share their successes both at Kodak and then in later years as they moved on to other companies. And in my present job, helping people negotiate employment agreements and move from Kodak either to a new employer or to retirement, you really get to know people well. And so you share in their successes. And there's an awful lot of successes and a lot of good things that people have experienced after leaving the company.
So it's really that ability to form long-standing relationships because you're at a company for so long and your parents were at that company or your friends were at that company already. So you've really developed some very strong, long-lasting relationships through Kodak.
That's correct. It's the lasting relationships, the people. You know, the companies say that people are their most important resource, and that was truly the case at Kodak for a number of years. And people that I've spoke with are, they remember the good times. They may have to forget the last 12 months or 24 months, but they remember the 30, 40 years of good times and successes and friends and in many cases, husbands and wives that they met at Kodak. So
I know you and I were talking earlier that all the support that Kodak gave had a downside. People started to expect Kodak to take care of them and sometimes were surprised. And you told me a story about someone who came to your office wondering what Kodak was going to do to fix that. I believe it was a 401k or something that didn't quite measure up to what they expected.
Right. There was an entitlement philosophy or mindset that people's expectations were built up. In fact, I had suggested somewhat tongue-in-cheek at one point that as a benefit that we give everybody a couple weeks off to look for a job every year because people didn't understand what it was like to be outside of the Kodak umbrella. But the story you're referring to very vividly demonstrates this, you told me everything that I should do. Everything you said was right, right? Mm-hmm. The individual came to me, he said his 401k statement was wrong. And he'd been to several other places in the organization. And I said, sir, I don't see what's wrong with your statement. He says, well, you're no smarter than anybody else in this place. I said, well, sir, you know, what you're looking at is that you have less money than you today than what you put into the plan. He says, yes, you told me to go into company stock, meaning the HR department, 35 years ago, and you never told me to come out. And I want to know when you're going to make up this mistake in my benefit statement, because clearly it's a mistake. And you've always told me the right things to do. And I said, well, tell me some other ways that the company told you the right things to do. He said, my safety glasses, my shoes, my clothes, you housed me, you fed me. You never did anything to help me think for myself. Mm-hmm. Right? And all of a sudden...
People really relied
exactly, and that was the essence of these 401k plans, was that people, the participants, had to bear the investment risk mm-hmm. and make decisions for themselves.
And that was a different mindset for the
Totally different workforce. Than the traditional defined benefit mm-hmm. Kodak retirement income plan.
I want to get into, so you work with the retirees at Tompkins. I want to get into that in just a minute. But first I want to talk about when you heard the news. Obviously not a big surprise. People saw it coming that Kodak mm-hmm. would likely file for bankruptcy. Where were you and this morning? And what was your initial reaction?
You told me about it. When you called and early this morning, Rachel, and said, we'd like you to, would you be interested in talking about the Kodak bankruptcy? And I thought she was talking prospectively, you know, in the future. And then the news hit me. I like you, was involved in walking dogs and a lot of other things. Mm-hmm. So,
yeah.
And it being as close to a lot of the people as we are, and when you're doing financial advising and experiencing their concerns, their worries, and sorting through what's real and what's not in terms of what to worry about. Mm-hmm. We understood that clearly there were going to be some changes, mm-hmm. but we're somewhat surprised that it was January 19th.
Right. Nobody expected it to wake up. Right. I don't know if there's any day that people would have expected to wake up
no.
to it. So what happened when you got to work? You counsel so many Kodak retirees on their investments and their pensions and their life savings. Did you hear from any of them today?
For a brief few moments until our phones and internet went down due to an accident out in Bushnell's Basin. And so we were in the dark. So we employed cell phones and were able to communicate with people. And we tried to reach out to a lot of our clients because we knew they'd be trying to call us just to provide comfort and tell them we're here for them and try to dispel a lot of the misunderstandings.
What are some of the biggest misunderstandings that are out there among retirees?
Well, one of the biggest misunderstandings is that the retirement plans, the tax-qualified funded retirement plans, where there's money put in by the company or there's money put in by participants in the case of 401k plans, and it's set aside in a trust fund and it's protected from bankruptcy, change in control, management indiscretion, mm-hmm. if you will. And some of the financial media has encouraged some of this irrational thinking, and there's an ad out there that says you've left your employer. 401k plan doesn't like your former employer any more than you do. Well, that's imbuing something to 401k plans that they don't contain emotions,
mm-hmm.
right?
So, you're right.
So one of the big misunderstandings is that my traditional pension plan is going to go the same direction that the company goes in, or that my 401k plan. But the fact is that the money is protected by law and by practice from access by management or by any other party, except in the case of a divorce situation where there's mm-hmm. what they call.
So are there any actual fears out there that are warranted among your clients?
Sure. There's in the Q&As on the reorganization website, they reference very clearly that the QRIP and KRIP payments will stop. Well, most people have no idea what those mean.
I have no idea.
But there's, if you're highly compensated and long service, you could have a portion of your pension paid from working capital or operating cash flow rather than from the Kodak Retirement Income Trust Fund. So that portion of your pension as a highly compensated individual would only be paid to the extent that Kodak is financially able to do so.
Mm-hmm.
Those payments have stopped. They've stopped affected with
would
the filing date.
Would those be former executives then?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes, they'd be former executives.
So those, did they stop as of the bankruptcy or they stopped prior to it?
They stopped as of
the bankruptcy filing.
As of the bankruptcy filing, right.
Okay.
So one of the key questions is, how do I restructure my portfolio to help replace that income?
Mm-hmm.
We've been addressing that question quite a bit. Another question concerns the fixed fund in the 401k plan, SIP. There's a lot of concern. There's about 60-70% of the money in SIP. And there's about $6 billion in SIP. So $4.5 billion is in this fixed fund because it's what people most easily understand and it's had a very good returns. People think that because Kodak chooses the managers to manage that fund, that it could go the same way as the company. That's not the case. So that's been another fear that we've addressed.
Okay, so you're going to have to keep working on it for some time, it sounds like, not just dealing with finances, but dealing with emotions of these people.
Yeah.
Well, I appreciate you coming in today, and I hope your power is on tomorrow so you can help those people
Thank
out.
Thank you, Julie.
John Lawson, Vice President with Tompkins Financial Advisors and a former member of the Kodak family in Rochester. WXXI News covered so many angles of the story today. Many of those stories are on our website, WXXINews.org. Our media engagement director, Steve Daw, has more about what you will find there.
That's right, Julie. We've got a lot of content on our website. WXXINews.org is where we've been posting all of our content, all of our stories all day long. There are stories right here on the main page. You see the Kodak declares bankruptcy story. This is where everything branches out from here. And from there, you can get to other stories, including we have a story that Zack Seward did from our Innovation Trail reporter, WXXI Innovation Trail reporter Zack Seward, the future after Chapter 11. And that kind of has a detailing of many of the people that Kodak owes money to, who those creditors are. And it's a very, it includes the actual filing, the actual paperwork itself that you can take a look at. That's part of Zach's reporting today. Also, retirees. Alex Crichton on Morning Edition did an extensive interview with Bob Volpe, who is the president of ECRA, the Kodak Retirees Association. They've been monitoring the situation all along, and they are determined to protect what is coming to Kodak retirees. More than 25,000 local retirees Kodak has, and this is a very big issue for them going forward. And Bob Volpe and Alex, they talk about the issues facing these retirees. You can listen to that interview here online as well. And then something really neat, a filmmaker, a Greece native, he's a film student, he made a film about Kodak's role during the Cold War. And you can look at it here. You see Corey Robinson, he made this small short film about Kodak and a spying program that Kodak was a part of. Kodak workers sworn to secrecy, couldn't talk about for years, only until recently when they were allowed to come out and talk about it. So those are some of the things. You can click on that, watch that film right there on our website. It's a terrific little piece of history. And, of course, all of the material we've been gathering will go right here to our main page. It will continue to be updated throughout the evening tonight and tomorrow morning, as well as we get more and as the story develops, just like we've been following it all along, Kodak's new chapter. Julie?
Thanks, Steve, and thank you for joining us on this special edition of Need to Know Rochester. Over the years, WXXI has produced many stories about Kodak. Up next on WXXI, our documentary program, Invented Here. Invented Here was produced in 1999 and explores the history of Kodak from its early days in Rochester to the beginning of the digital age. Invented Here is up next. I will see you back here tomorrow night for our regularly scheduled Need to Know Rochester. Our guest, Monroe County Executive Maggie Brooks, and that starts at 8:30 tomorrow night. We leave you now with some video from Kodak's history. Some of the biggest and most memorable Kodak moments. Many thanks to Michael Champlin of De Bergerac Productions for the use of this video. Have a great night.